My name is Shabnam Mujtahedi, and I will be talking about Benetech's Justice AI initiative, where we are leveraging emerging technology for justice. What is the problem we're trying to solve? Human rights and war crimes investigators have been overwhelmed with the volume of digital media collected from conflict and repressive environments, where people have digital cameras and smartphones and are filming everything happening around them and posting it to social media. This information can prove valuable for accountability and truth processes, but these investigators have been overwhelmed with the time and high costs of manual analysis. They've also been overwhelmed with the duplicate and related video, and identifying it with missing or inaccurate metadata is a huge challenge. There's also the cost of archiving and storage, especially for low-resourced organizations over time. Risks of secondary trauma to staff who are viewing graphic content day in and day out. And finally, these challenges are multiplied when an entity is tasked with collecting data from many different data sources. So who are our partners? Nowhere is the problem more critical than in Syria. We are partnered with the United Nations Investigative Mechanism for Syria and Syrian civil society organizations to co-design different functionalities that will help them make the most use out of artificial intelligence, including machine learning and computer vision. But the applications for human rights and justice are numerous. There are other conflict situations where activists and media are filming atrocities. There's crackdowns on protests worldwide, including in the US over the summer. There's international and tribunals and truth commissions that are mandated with redressing conflict. And then there's investigative journalists who are working to dig and find the truth and post that to the public. So at Benetech, in line with our mission, we are developing technology to support investigators seeking truth and justice for individuals impacted by conflict and human rights abuses all over the world. What are the benefits of these tools? So we've created a platform where users can process digital media to cluster and generate basic classifications, increasing their effectiveness and efficiency. They're able to identify duplicate and related video through a fingerprinting system where each fingerprint is matched with the actual content of the video, not the underlying metadata, so that even when there's small changes in the video, they can be identified as related. They can identify the number of scenes in a video and match scenes according to relationships. They can identify basic objects and do reverse frame search. They can extract key metadata and sort according to the metadata. And finally, they can filter out corrupt videos, all in order to make sure that they're getting to the most relevant information that's useful for their investigation. We're creating a platform that allows investigators to visualize the results, not just process them, but actually visualize them in unique ways and securely work across data silos to identify common files and facilitate collaboration where it wouldn't otherwise be possible. Finally, we're enabling justice mechanisms to make targeted requests for data so that they're not just reaching out to human rights organizations and asking for their entire collections, which they're reluctant to do, but to work efficiently and work more collaboratively to identify what's most relevant for the investigations and ingest their data strategically. I'll turn it over to John so that he can explain more of the technical requirements and also provide a demo of the platform. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Shabnam. So like Shabnam said, I'm John Higgins, Director of Engineering for Benetech Labs. Today, I'll be giving a demo of the Justice AI platform itself. Like we alluded to in the processing pipeline, when we get a video, we pull a lot of kind of basic information from the file, like the file name and the file duration and the created date, you know, whatever we can find on the file, we'll extract it. And then we do this later more sophisticated processing to find similar videos based on visual content. So I think, you know, there's two kind of sections of the platform. One is around increasing efficiency of exploring these data sets. So just basic stuff that I won't show, but like searching and sorting and filtering. So saying, hey, I want to find a video that I know was created between this date. And maybe, you know, I want only the versions that are over 2 minutes long. And they need to be at least of this quality, you know, so something like that, really helping you explore these large, you know, data sets. But then I think the really important part is those higher level insights that you really only get with this type of processing. It's really hard and painstaking to get that from a manual review. So before I jump in, I'll say that we are using a test data set, that it's a publicly available research data set. I won't be using human rights videos because they can be quite graphic, but I will try to tie it back to kind of real world use cases. So I'm going to click into a video. So in this display, we see, you know, the video player itself, if we have the source media available to us, and then all that information I talked about that we extract on the right. So things like length of video and file extension, et cetera. Two other features I'll quickly draw out is we do automatic scene detection. So places where the camera point of view might have changed, or if the subject changed or there was an edit in the video, we kind of call out those keyframes and allow you to jump to that point in video to get kind of a more interactive exploration of how the video changes over time. In addition, this data is stand-in for the demo, but we do object detection as well. So you could provide us a couple images of a flag, for instance, and then we say, here's a couple timestamps where we think that flag appears in this video. So just a few quick examples. And then I'll play the video now. And it's a scene from the movie Titanic. So it's the famous kind of front of the ship scene. But I think what's interesting is it's a handheld recording. So it's someone recording their television playing the movie Titanic. So in fact, they just changed the volume. So the volume slider just showed up on the screen. But it's low resolution, super shaky. You know, the colors are blown out. So a quite low quality version of this scene. So I'm going to go over to the files matched view, and we can see that there are 19 files that we found in the data set that matched. So in addition to high level information for each match, we also have this concept of match score, where a match score of 1 means it's the exact same, you know, don't bother looking at the content because it'll be the exact same. And as it goes closer to 0, it gets more similar than exact duplicates. So I think what's interesting, I'll click on the match score of 1, and we could see as I play them, they're, you know, they are the exact same, you know, shaky cam version of it. I think what's interesting is one video might have some metadata attached to it that the other didn't, the actual file. And so even though they're the exact same, you might find a created date that's slightly earlier, or some key piece of a timestamp or something that the other file didn't have. So that's one use case for maybe looking at a duplicate in some sense. I'll skip over to the next match, which is a 0.449. And this is a actual high quality version of that scene. So something that was taken from a VHS or a DVD possibly. And so this could be super useful if you can imagine a case where you have a really low res version of an event that happened, someone recording on a cell phone, and then maybe a high res version of someone recording with a higher quality camera or a camera that was on a tripod. And from that, you can get maybe a more detail, like a piece of text or a license plate or something that you couldn't have gotten from the other version. So a key use case there. I'll jump down to a further away match. So this one's 0.31. And so this is actually another handheld recording, but it's of a movie theater instead. So a great example of, you know, two different vantage points of the same visual scene. And so you can imagine someone recording from two different rooftops and maybe, like I said, a lot of details that you would lose between the two versions. And then just another quick one. This is the same high quality version of the scene, but there's text overlaid. So you can imagine with these types of videos, there's a lot of different news agencies posting them. So subtitles, no subtitles, logos, banners, the algorithm can learn to kind of ignore all of those and not make you look at all these copies of the same file. So I'll also quickly show another visualization we use, and something called the cluster visualization. So in this visualization, each video is represented by a circle, and the circles are connected by lines whose length is related to how closely related they are. And so this is also really key because it shows matches of the parent file, but also like matches of matches of matches. So you get this like really expansive view of like, here's this file that's a couple jumps away that you might not have realized was related just, you know, at first glance. So really bringing out high level insights that you might not have been able to find, or it would have been really costly time-wise to find manually. So a quick little demo of the platform. Thank you.